this video, I'm going to be teaching you how to tie a number of knots. The main purpose of the video will be instructional, but I hope you also find it relaxing and maybe also receive some tingles, as there will be rope sounds and tapping and things like that. So, I'm going to get started right away, and to do that, we're going to go ahead and change the camera angle so you'll be able to see my hands as I tie the various knots. So, give me a moment to go ahead and do that, and let's get started. Enjoy. Okay, so for this demo, I have cut a couple of pieces of paracord. Now, paracord is, like the name sounds, used for rigging parachutes. To that end, it is very thin and light. It is still very strong. For the main knot demonstrations, I will be using some hemp rope, but I wanted to show some knots that use two different sizes of rope as well. So the paracord will be useful for that. I'm also going to use it to tie a couple of lashings, since I'll be using some smaller pieces of wood in order to show you guys. Now, paracord is a synthetic material. It consists of an inner core of fibers. That's these white fibers extending out, and that's surrounded by a sheath to protect those, which is this woven black set of fibers. Now, because I cut this, you can see that it is frayed. That won't be very helpful for tying knots. Be pushing this end through the loops and turns, and it'll just make the situation worse and be hard to pass it through. So we're gonna treat this end, and the easiest way to do that is with some flame, and we will fuse all of these fibers together by melting. process is pretty simple. All you do is place the end that you're trying to fuse into the candle flame, and the fibers will immediately begin to melt, and we'll just do a little bit of shaping of that end to make sure it's a tight ball with no fibers sticking out of it. Set that aside to make sure it cools down before I touch it. And we will do the other piece of cord. Now, this end I already did, and it's looking pretty good. So we're going to leave that one. But this one is pretty ragged, as you can see. Scissors handy, but I would cut those white fibers to match the black, so there's not as much work to be done in fusing those. But since we're here, you might have been able to see that there was a drip that happened there. So as I mentioned, you need to be very careful when doing this. It would have been less likely to drip had I pre-trimmed that material, as we would have been burning less of these. About this is that the fumes are fairly noxious. Using this for most of the demonstrations, along with the paracord I mentioned earlier. This is probably about a 10-foot length, but for most of the knots, we're only going to be using a little bit of that, since we're just showing how to do them, depending on where you're using them. Some better ways to finish the end of a rope, like whipping or splicing, and we might look at how to do those in a future video if there is interest. But for now, that is not so important. We just need a piece of rope use for our demonstration, and this one is a really good one for doing just that. If you would like to follow along, you can use any piece of rope that you have handy, and you will likely be able to do most of the knots that we are looking. Of course. are very welcome to just watch for relaxation. The first knot we will be doing is the overhand knot. I'm sure many of you will be familiar with this knot. It's one pretty much everyone learns how to tie. It's not all that useful on its own, but it is a basis for some other knots, so it's good to know it as a starting point. To tie the overhand knot, you simply pass one end of the rope over the other. Loop it down, underneath, and back up. So you have a knot that looks like that. This is the way that we begin to tie our shoelaces, so it should be quite familiar. Over and under. Necessarily the strongest knot to use, but it is very convenient and effective in many situations. You most commonly encounter it when you tie your shoes, as that is actually the same type of knot as a square knot. So, to tie the square knot, with an overhand knot, passing over and then under. Now, we have our overhand knot. We are going to repeat that by tying another overhand knot. About this knot is it is very symmetrical. There's this loop which has both of these ropes passing through it, and there's this loop which has both of these sections of the rope passing through it. That is a proper square knot. To remember that when tying it is to go right over left, and then when you tie the second, swap those. So we tie left over right, and this produces that symmetrical knot. If you do them two overhand knots without swapping the side, which goes over the top, you will tie a granny knot. So if I go right over left, and then right over left again, I have not tied a square knot, but rather a granny knot. Now you see, in the square knot, both of these sections of the rope went through this loop, the same direction. Now they are going opposite directions. This knot is less strong than the square knot, which is why we don't want to tie it. So, right over left, place square knot. Now, I'm sure many of you know this already, or just picked up on it, but when we tie our shoelaces, we start with an overhand knot, and then we make figure eight knot from from before, but it is now doubled. And we have this loop here which we can use. The figure eight knot is a very strong knot to use when you need a loop. This rope could be attached to something using this loop, and the way the rope passes through itself provides a lot of strength and doesn't produce a lot of tension against itself, which could help break that rope. So this is a very useful knot. Many knots have more than one way to tie them that will give you the same result. And you can tie the one that is easiest for you or most convenient. There is another way to tie the figure eight loop, and that is to tie a figure eight knot over, under, and back through. And now, if you take the end of your rope and use it to pass back through the knot, following itself through the loop, you will end up with the figure eight loop. So we go through, around, tracking exactly along the path in reverse that this rope came through. And wrapping around and back through to the start point. And you'll see that we have ended up with the same figure eight knot with a loop that we did before. Now you can see that it was a little bit fuzzier to have to pass the rope through the path that it came through, which is why I like tying this knot the first way, starting with a loop and tying the figure eight knot. So we'll have have this free end, and then using the main length of rope, we want to form a small loop, just like that. We can do it just by twisting a section of rope, and you'll create this smaller loop. Now, the direction and orientation of this loop is important, and there's a way that we help remember this and remember how to tie the knot as a whole. W-H-O-L-E. Because I'm about to talk about this hole. When tying the bowline, a device we can use to remember is to talk about the rabbit coming out of the hole, around the tree, and back into his hole. So this is going to be the hole, and this is the tree that we are talking about. So this section that forms the tree must be underneath this section of rope forming the hole. So this tree needs to come out from under the ground. Not like this, where it's over, but under. With practice, you'll realize the direction to twist, because you'll be holding the rope in this hand and twisting it, rotating your hand towards your other hand. But however you want to form that loop, the important thing is that this tree, the main body of rope, is underneath this section. So now that we've formed our loop, we'll take the other end of the rope and we'll pass it up through that loop. The rabbit comes out of the hole, around the tree, and back down the hole. And then we simply pull on the tree to help tighten the knot. And that is a bowline. Once you get the hang of it, it is very easy to tie and is a very effective knot to use. You'll see that the knot is here and it has created this loop of rope, which we can use once that tightens up. This knot will not slip, and that loop will maintain its size. Let's try that again. Interesting not to know. and other knots. The sheep shank is the knot we will be tying next. And the sheep shank is ostensibly used to shorten a length of rope. And I will show you what I mean. And then we'll look at that unique role that it can play, if necessary, once you've seen what it looks like. So, we're starting with a length of rope, and I have the end of my rope. I'm not at the end of my rope, I have the end of my rope. And the rest of this rope stretches off. Side of the S into that loop. So when you pull these tight, they clamp down on those S loops like this. So what we've done by making that S-shaped loop is we've tied up that extra length of rope within the boundaries of this knot, thus shortening the working length of rope that we have. Now, this knot requires tension to stay in position. If there's not tension on it, it's easy for those loops to come out. Itself, even though it was cut here, would still be capable of holding tension. That way, when I was done using the rope for the application I was had tied this knot for, I could shake out the knot. Use a sheet bend to tie these two together. Now, I could tie a square knot we don't use the square knot in this application. With the sheet bend, I make a loop in my larger rope. I pass the smaller rope up through that loop. I wrap it around, and then I pass it back underneath itself, like that. And then I can pull these tight. Let's try that again. It's the sheet bend. So that was the sheet bend, which allows us to attach two ropes of different sizes together. Now, there is a slightly different version of this knot, which is a little bit less likely to come undone, and it is called usually a double sheet bend, or I've also seen it referred to as an improved sheet bend, and it is quite similar in how it's constructed to the sheet bend. We have our two ropes of different diameters. We take the thicker rope and form a loop, just like we did for the sheet bend. Then we take our smaller rope and insert it up through the loop, around the rope. At this point, we are doing exactly what we did for the standard sheet bend. However, we come underneath the smaller rope where it came out of the hole, and around the larger rope one more time before finishing underneath the smaller rope, like we did to finish off the standard sheet bend. And then we can pull this tight, and it has a second loop providing friction to keep this knot from sliding out. So that is the double sheet bend. Let's tie that one more time. So, we make a loop, the larger rope, pass the smaller loop up through, around, underneath itself, back around, and underneath itself again. you might find cause to do at some point is to make a loop in the middle of your rope. Now, there are some different ways to do that. A very simple one is to form a loop and use it to tie an overhand knot with itself. And now you have a loop in the middle of your rope. However, because this is just an overhand knot, it is not very strong. A better way to do this is to use a knot called the Alpine Butterfly. At least, I'm pretty sure that's the name of it. I learned this knot without a name attached, but I believe when I was looking it up, it is called the Alpine Butterfly. Now this knot is a very good and strong knot that is really quite simple to tie, but might be a little bit difficult to see exactly how you do it in this video. But I think if you give it a shot, you will quickly get the hang of it. So we have a length of rope in which we want to form a loop. So we form a bump like this, or a wave, and then grab that loop and twist, folding it over itself. So we have a loop like this. We twist it, folding it over itself, and then twist it in the same direction a second time. So now I have this loop and a smaller loop from that original twist. It kind of looks like a shape of an 8. Now I take this loop that I've made and I'm going to bring it down around the main section of the rope and back up through this hole that we made. So I'm folding it over, passing it underneath, and coming up through that hole. And now we have a loop in our rope that is quite strong and is fairly easy to untie as well, even when it's had a load on it, which can be nice. So, let's go through tying that again. Hold on to this. I don't lose this loop that I need to come back through. I'm going to bring this loop down past the main section of the rope, looping it around and back up through that smaller loop. And there we have it. One more time. Form our hill. We twist. Twist again in the same direction. Fold this down. Under. Back up through that inner loop. And there you have it. Now, there is another way to tie that, and potentially some of you will find it easier. I'm not going to go through it right now, but perhaps in a future video. For me, this is the easiest way, and it's the one I'm most used to. But as I said before, many knots have more than one way to create them, and that is another example. Instead, we're going to move on to the clove hitch. Also, the knot used to start a number of lashings, which we'll cover at the end of this video. So, as I said, which is used to attach to a pole or something like that. So I'm going to use this stick to tie my clovage on. So we go around our pole, over. See how we end up with an X shape. Come back around one more time and pass the end underneath itself. And that is the clovage. It will hold tension, easily loosened to remove it. So we go around our pole, over the rope to form that X shape, around one more time, and underneath the rope. So you'll know you have tied the clovage properly, because you'll have this rope crossing over both ends of the rope and the ends will be pointed in opposite directions. So this end loops around this way and it points off in this direction, while this end points the other direction. That is the sign that you have tied a good clovage. You'll also notice that it looks like two of the same basic knot, just opposite each other. It also has kind of a nice eight or infinity symbol shape when spread out like this. But you want to see that X with the rope ends in opposite direction. I showed you to start with can be tied anywhere along the pole. But if we have the ability to slip loops over the end, then we can tie the clove knot hitch slightly differently. So, as I showed you, it kind of looks like two loops that are opposite each other. And that is exactly how we will create this version. I will make a loop in the rope. You'll see this segment comes over the main rope, and the end is pointed this direction. Now I can make another loop. Again, it comes over this section of the rope, but you can see now that the end is pointed in opposite directions, and thus the loops are pointed in opposite directions. Now, I fold one loop onto the other, and I can slip this on the end of the ball, and then I simply have to tighten. You'll see we've ended up with the clovage. We have this rope going across, and the ends are pointed in opposite directions, just like that. you'll note that I just made the exact same knot with a slightly different method. This is a slightly different variation with the same end result. I fold one loop over and another loop over as well. You see, this one crosses over this, and this one crosses over at this point. Now, I slide these one behind the other, and the loop that goes on top is critical because we want both of these lines behind the other. You can slip it on. And we have our clovage. You can use whichever method you prefer. You'll see that this end of the rope goes in an opposite direction from this last half hitch that I made. That is the correct orientation for this knot. We can pull. Thank you. additional friction coming from that loop. The two have it just not at the end is the same. The other side of the rope, underneath, around, and back through. It is also the basis for some lashings. So we run the rope around our piece of wood, over the rope, and then we are just going to wind this end around itself. In your rope. repeat that over and under process on the other side. So over, then back under. Instead of over and under the sticks. So, what that means is I will be over the lower one, under the upper one, over the lower one, and under the upper one. So now what I've done is made a wrap of the cord around basically the joint of this lashing. And if I pull on that, it pulls these cords that are woven around the sticks tightly together. So let's do that again. Thank you. is your square lashing. Okay, the last lashing we're going to do is the shear lashing. And this is going to allow us to tie two sticks together that are side by side. We will again start with a clovage on one of the sticks. Thank you. some knots that you might end up using at some point in your life. I hope you have a wonderful evening, and I hope to see you again.